Welcome. Hopefully, Chabi Jaldi Ause, so we're nice and awake. Bellies are full. We're going to get started. Thank you for coming. This is an opportunity to discuss pathways in medicine outside of the usual medical school pathway. I'm going to let our panelists speak for themselves, but just brief introductions. Sakina Bin Chiba, Sakina Bin, wave out to everyone, is the owner of SafeNet Solutions, which is a pharmacy consulting service. She is born and raised in UK, has lived in California, and now lives in Houston. She's a mom, she's a wife, she teaches madrasa, wears a lot of hats, but her passion is advocating for women entrepreneurship. So she will talk to us briefly. After that, we have Tasneem Bain Kambati. Sorry, I'm going to toggle a little bit. Dr. Tasneem Bain is a clinical health psychologist by training and has her early career in investigation work with interface of behavioral medicine and aging. Her program of research aims to prevent or delay cardiometabolic disease and preserve cognitive and functional independence into later life. Kind of has been the theme of today. Research has been well organized in high impact journals, and she's received several extramural grants, including grants from National Institute of Aging. She serves on the editorial board of the two leading journals in behavioral medicine, psychosomatic medicine, and health psychology, as well as on NIH, National Institutes of Health, study section as an early career reviewer. Thank you, Tasneem Bain. Zara Bain is in navy blue. Say hi, Zara. Zara Bain Bori is a registered dietitian and certified diabetes educator. She has experience in inpatient and outpatient medical nutrition therapy and counseling in lifestyle changes for chronic disease. Her current role is an obesity educator for Novo Nordisk. And finally, we have Dr. Munira Bain Westray, who some of you may remember from last year, obtained her bachelor's and master's from Pune University, PhD, go Pune, from University of Tennessee at Knoxville, and her PhD training, a postdoctoral training at Johns Hopkins. Dr. Westray joined the National Institutes of Health in 1998 as a senior scientist in genetics branch of the NCI, National Cancer Institute. She's been at the NIH for 25 years. Do not ask her age. She's very young, very experienced. Her research is focused on defining mechanisms of chromosomal instability, a hallmark of cancers using model systems and mammalian cells. Dr. Westray serves on several committees, including the Cancer Advisory Board. She has received numerous awards for her mentorship, and her trainees are pursuing independent research careers in academia and industry, and loves the student-mentor relationship. So without further ado, I'm going to let the panelists showcase their talents and their career paths, and then the majority of the time, hopefully, we'll have an engaging discussion. Thank you again, and Sakina.
Okay, so today I'm going to talk specifically about my career as a health professional, but how I transitioned to get my own business. As you know, she said, I had my business, SafeNet Solutions, which I established in 2017. I've been the owner of that, and it is a specific niche. And I'm going to chat a little bit about my journey and how I went from being a health professional and then started my own business as a health professional. So a little bit about me. I did my bachelor's in pharmacy in King's College London. I also did my internship and my residency in a tertiary pediatric specialist hospital. I did my residency there for 2 years, then got married, as life would sometimes take you, moved to California. When I came to California, I had to do more exams. I had to do a whole equivalency exam to transition that my bachelor's was going to be equivalent to the PharmD or the bachelor program here. When I did my foreign equivalency, I had to then do state board exams, and I worked as a retail pharmacist with CVS. And if any of you are pharmacists or pharmacy children who love, you know, work for CVS, that's a really good motivation to leave retail pharmacy. All right. So I did that for 15 years, primarily because as a woman, as a womanette, I had my kids. They worked with my schedule, and I earned every penny I worked for when I worked with them. Okay, I did that for 15 years. Circumstances led us to move to Texas, and that's where SafeNet Solutions was born. So when I came to Texas, it was leaving one country to another country, okay? California is very different, Texas very different. And at the time, it was a big change for my family also. I did not want to go back to CVS. This was my way out. I really didn't want to go back into retail. Because I came from England, and a lot of us as foreign students, I did not have a PharmD. I could not do clinical rotations. Clinical was my passion. So I really had to rethink what I wanted to do. And I had some mindset of what I wanted. I wanted flexibility. I was an active mom. I'm a Muminat. If you're a Muminat and you're active, you have to juggle many, many things in 24 hours. So I had to retrain my mind. And this is the biggest thing I want you guys to take away from my journey, that I went from professional-minded to business-minded. And for me, that was huge. I have never had to explain to another pharmacy company what a pharmacist does. We do it. I have never even interviewed for a job because it was very obvious what a pharmacist does. When I wanted to start my business, I had to really think about what I did as a profession and what I was doing for the community. So this was my big crossroads. So this was my new pathway. I wanted flexibility. I wanted to work from home. I loved the clinical part of my profession. I didn't want to give that up. I still wanted to be, you know, a mom. I wanted to support independent pharmacies because I knew the struggle as a pharmacist on being an independent pharmacist, trying to do everything and earn money. And I found a niche where I could do all of this. So I wanted my cake and eat it. And Molendoasi, I've been trying to do that. So what did I do? I went into a specific niche. I provided medication counseling to patients with chronic diseases. I do that exclusively. I'm part of the pharmacy community. Pharmacy community, the business, pharmacy businesses are my main clientele. I help them with their patients. And then I'm still able to be an active healthcare professional, a wife, a mother, a Muminat, and all the things that are required by our community also. So alhamdulillah, magani shukur karushu that I'm able to do that. There was a journey. It's not easy. I took a pay cut, but these are all the things that are part of it. So what do I do now? So for the community, how do I help? What has SafeNet done for me and as a career path? SafeNet Solutions has allowed me to be a 24-hour service to our community. Muminin, Muminat, come to me all the time. Doctors don't have time. Pharmacists don't have time. You go and get a prescription from CVS. They do not have time to talk to you about their medication. I do. I love talking, okay? So they love talking. They love listening to me. So I've become a 24-hour service. Been I Dr. Manikidu Manisamadnuti Pradi Tamizirakar, so I will be there for them. I'm a healthcare resource. I definitely don't know all the answers, but I know people who do. I network because of my business. I'm able to send people off in the right direction, specifically from our Muminin. And I'm a huge advocate of everybody doing their own business. If anything I've learned from this journey of mine is that anybody, and I mean anybody, if I can do it, any of you can do it. You can do your own business from your home, from wherever you want to do it, Bali, Bahamas, choose it, but you really can. And for Beira, I'm a big advocate for that because I know our life is like juggling a lot. Maradovaste also, but specifically for Beira. So I do thank you all for being here. Here's my contact information. If you have any questions, are we doing them now or towards the end? Okay, and thank you. Shukran jazeela.
I'm Christine Kambati. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Psychology at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County, where I lead the Cognition, Affect, and Cardiometabolic Health Research Lab. So first, how did I get where I am? I started with a bachelor's degree in psychology and neuroscience. followed by 5 years of doctoral work and a year of clinical residency. So as a graduate student, I focused on a field called behavioral medicine, health psychology, which I will get to in a second. And then during residency, I was really honing my skills delivering cognitive behavioral therapy, motivational interviewing, prolonged exposure, and other evidence-based clinical interventions in a VA setting. So after this, I completed a two-year NIH-funded T32 postdoctoral fellowship in behavioral medicine research in cardiovascular diseases. So here is where I'm really specializing in cardiometabolic disease pathology, epidemiology, prevention, and management. So now, as an assistant professor, what do I do? Usually, my day involves focusing on one of four things. So I spent the majority of my time as a principal investigator and collaborator. So I'm writing grants, getting them funded, hopefully, collecting clinical data, writing up papers, and publishing papers. I teach 1 to 2 courses per semester. So I teach a health psychology undergraduate course, and then I also teach a clinical interventions graduate course. I serve as primary mentor for graduate students who are obtaining their own PhDs. And then in my service, I focus on service to the department, to the university, to the profession, and the community in things like grant and journal reviews, editorial boards, committee meetings, that kind of thing. Okay, so as I mentioned before, as a researcher, I'm really housed within a field called behavioral medicine, which really focuses on integrating the mind, the brain, the body, and the social context into medicine, right? So you've all probably heard of cases where a broken heart leads to early death, or too much excitement at a ball game leads to angina or MI, right? What exactly is going on there? What are the biological, psychological, and social mechanisms by which these events are occurring? In other words, how does stress get under the skin, right? How does the brain and mind influence the body? This is what behavioral medicine is really focused on. And to give you a little bit of an example, researchers in behavioral medicine are focused, for example, on the association between depression and type 2 diabetes. Didn't know there was one, right? Or the association between stress and CHD, right? Folks are looking at the links between systemic inflammation and cognitive dysfunction, right? And then they're trying to focus on the neuroanatomy of grief and complicated grief. So behavioral medicine is really a multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary field of research. It takes a village to do this. So I regularly and successfully collaborate with folks in medicine, in epidemiology, in public health, as well as biostatistics. Okay, so in my lab, my research team and I are really focused on identifying early vulnerabilities to cardiometabolic health and related accelerated aging. So we are really trying to understand the mechanisms by which depression and anxiety increase the risk for glucose dysregulation, right? Which in turn accelerates the aging trajectory, leading to dementia at an early age, right? So studies from my lab have shown, for example, that depressive disorders are actually linked to MI in those with HIV. That anxiety actually predicts incident diabetes independent of depressive symptoms in individuals who are at risk for diabetes. And now we have a grant where we are really trying to understand the mechanisms by which glucose dysregulation affects your thinking, particularly your executive functions. Switching gears a little, my work as an instructor and as a mentor is equally rewarding because I'm learning all the time. I'm learning from my students. I'm learning in every class that I teach along with my students. And I also get to pay it forward by training the next generation of scientists. Okay. We know that diabetes is highly, highly prevalent in those in our community, in among Mominin across the globe. And we don't even know what the prevalence of depression is or dementia in our communities across the world. So in my service to the community, I really focus on primary prevention. That is, how do we do health promotion before the disease actually begins? Right? Ajay Desawarna, you probably saw, you probably heard Ibrahim Basha talk about prevention rather than cure, right? And we can't do that by focusing on biology alone, right? So I try to share my expertise in the integration of the psychological, the social, and the biological context in disease prevention, right? And apne, I think khuda taala no ghanu ghanu shukr ka ye ke apna mola se na sanali ka mufaddam safuddin mola ye apne eva mahol ma tarbiyat ki disha eva environment ma tarbiyat ki disha ke apne a lot of things that really like synergistically influence both the brain and the body, right? A muharramat, a addictive behavior se apne bachaya che apne se apne hifazat ki disha. So if I can help you do what you do, please feel to reach out by email, and I'm happy to talk later as well.
Thank you. So my name is Zara Bori. I'm a registered dietitian, also currently an obesity educator for Novo Nordisk. And some of you might be very familiar now. I work for the company that makes Ozempic, Wegovy, and Rybelsus, the semaglutide molecule. So I started my career really thinking I would do something in biology. I'll do a BS. When I stumbled upon a human nutrition course, and when I did the human nutrition course, everything started to make sense. I understood organic chemistry. I started to understand biology. I understood the Krebs cycle even. It all really started to fit together. And that was like a moment where I'm just like, I'm going to do more of this. So in my career, what I decided to do was pursue a Bachelor's of Science in Nutrition. And with that, if I wanted to become a registered dietitian, the next thing I would have to do is also a master's degree. So I did a master's degree, and then after that, you have to do a one-year residency in order to become a registered dietitian. So for those people who call themselves dietitians have truly earned that, a nutritionist is not the same thing, FYI. So then what has that awarded me? Being a registered dietitian has really given me the opportunity to expand in so many different areas. I did research for about 3 years at the University of Alberta, studying fat metabolism in rodent models that were predisposed to obesity and cardiovascular disease. I got 4 publications out of that, which was very, you know, something I feel very accomplished for. I also got an opportunity to teach and be faculty at George Washington University and taught at Andrews Air Force Base. I got to participate in advocacy, something I never thought my degree would allow me to do, but I worked in BC for the Center of Science and Public Interest that is involved in a lot of food policy, and at the time we were working on changing the Farm Bill. And then finally, probably the thing that's closest to me is my clinical practice. I started working inpatient and outpatient, but in my outpatient experience, I started working with patients that have diabetes and decided to specialize in that. Specialization does require 1,000 hours of working in that field, and then also an exam that you need to take. But I am officially a certified diabetes educator. I think all of these experiences combined had finally led me to a job at Novo Nordisk. And so what does a dietitian really do at Novo Nordisk? I no longer really work with the patient, but the patient is still always the center of what I do. I work with physician groups, I work with health systems, pharmacies, corporations, and payers. And my role is really to start to build the importance of treating obesity. For those people that think after this talk this morning that we are all treating obesity, I will tell you we are not. There have been physicians that have told me that the only way that patients can lose weight is if they put duct tape over their mouths or if they tie their hands behind their backs. And you know what that has resulted in? 69% of patients with obesity feeling stigmatized by their doctor. And so when they feel stigmatized, they're not seeking treatment, they're not getting any help. There are also, if we think we're treating obesity, there are still over 100 million people in the United States that live with obesity, and 1% of them are only treated. The other thing is that when you have the help of a physician or provider for weight loss, you lose about 5 times more weight. And the final thing is that chronic weight management isn't about willpower. It is really about biology. And then my job is really to help change these statistics so that obesity treatment becomes something that we do. And if we realize that weight is the core of all the other comorbidities and we start treating it early, it could be really important in preventing some of the diseases that we're trying to band-aid today. And finally, how do I serve women? As a dietitian, there's probably not been a single time that I've sat in a towel or eaten with somebody and they have not asked me if it's okay for me to eat that, or for them to, or they've told me, please look away, I don't want you to see what I'm eating. But we have come very far in what we have done as a community in trying to do better and trying to eat healthier, and I'm very proud to be a part of a community that's working towards that initiative. Thank you.
Okay, now I'm really nervous because my son is here. Shukran Sam for coming. Auzubillahi Samil Alim and Shaitan Rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. My name is Munira Basrai, and I'm a scientist at the National Cancer Institute, the NIH. And today, what I'd really like to talk to you is not specifically about what I do and why I do. I really want this to be an inspiring story of where I came from, and with mullahs who are where I have reached. So even if you don't follow anything what I do in terms of research, this is my take-home lesson to you, and I hope you will all go home with more stronger faith about this. So I was born in a small town, Pune, which is not even on the map of India, and I did my bachelor's and master's in microbiology, and I swear to God I can say that I wanted to be a scientist the day my mom conceived me. And don't laugh about this, because it's true. I did want to do something in health, but I told my mom I cannot be a doctor. And so my goal really was to pursue a PhD in biomedical sciences. And I was born to parents who had never gone to college. We barely had money to put food on the table the next day. But my dad was a firm believer in giving his daughter the best education, because he thought that education would always stay with me for the rest of my life. And every time we went to Mola, he would say, "Mari dikri ne mane PhD karao chhe." Well, unfortunately, at the age of 51, my father walked into his grave with a massive heart attack. And my dream was going to come to an end. And after he died, we went to Mumbai, to Burhanuddin Mola, because my parents were very close to Mola. And my mom did arras to Mola, ke mara dikri ne Mola apni mohabbat karna ho koi jo veche. Next day, I met my to-be husband in Mullah's Hazrat. And Mullah looked at us and smiled and said, "Tame maljo." My first date with my husband, we were sitting in a park in Pune, and Adnan asked me, "What do you want to do for your career?" And I said, "I want to do my PhD and I want to go to America." And he said, "Wow, great. Even I want to go to America." And I came home and I told my mom, "I'm marrying this guy." And Mama said, "You know, what's wrong with you? We have to find out about his family." And I was like, "I don't care. He's taking me to America and I'm doing my PhD." Right? So we went to Mola, we got engaged, we got married at the hands of Burhanuddin Mola. Mola was not very very forthcoming with giving Raza to go to Mumineen. We were in Pune. Shehzadi Sahib Bhusab fortunately knew us. And Mola, we came came up with a lot of excuses. Mula kharcho karo che, mula maa yaad aavse, mula aa, mula ke na tu ja, tu paisa kama se, mara samay jo, mula mere PhD karu che, main aavi is tumhari khidmat kar che. Like mula just went on. So we landed in America with two suitcases. There was no GPS, there was no internet. We didn't know where the heck we were going. We end up in a small town in North Dakota, and we only had two bags, right? Like, that's where we started our career. But my very loyal and faithful husband stuck out with me. We came to the U.S. in 1985. I did my PhD in Tennessee, and mind well, not a lot of men will do that. My husband has moved from city to city to support my career. So we went to Tennessee, did my PhD, did Arastu Mula. Mula Burhanuddin said, Je Gama Muminin Vastao Tameta Jao. Of course, you know, Tennessee ma koi notu. So we moved to Baltimore. I had a very prestigious postdoctoral fellowship with a world famous scientist and was very happy because, you know, we had a Marcus to go. We had Namaz. We were always traveling 15 hours to go to Chicago, right? And I was very fortunate because that was very rare. And Adnan had moved with me from city to city. But this was the time I really didn't want to move. So I did Arastu Mula, and Mula Mara Shore, Badda Gama Mara Chate moved. Thai. Ab Dua Karo Mane A Gama Mali Jaya. As Mula's Dua, I got a prestigious position as a tenure track scientist. I really have to say that I'm one of the first Mumina who got a tenure track position at the Genetics Institute. For those of you who know, NIH has 26 institutes. It funds all the research throughout the United States. I was promoted to senior scientist in 2006. I'm having my 25th anniversary at NIH on Tuesday, and that's very gratifying. But let me tell you what my objective is, and I'm just going to say very briefly. So my objective is to find out the causes and consequences of chromosomal instability in human cancers. And as you can see, this is the slide of chromosomes from a normal cell. And all the chromosomes are either blue, green, you know, look very pretty. The picture on the right is a chromosome spread from a colorectal cancer patient. And as you can see, the chromosomes are all messed up. Blue binds with green, green is fused with blue. And while this might look as a beautiful panel on a radar, it's not a pretty picture for human cancers. And why did I do this? So, shukran, Ibrahim bhai sahab, aap hamari zikr ke liye fajr hai. I'm truly humbled and inspired. So Burhanuddin Mola ni ziyafat thi hamara ghar, the first ziyafat in Washington. And I told Mola that I was working on cures of cancer. And Burhanuddin Mola called me as he was leaving my house and strictly looked at me and said, tame cure na upar research na karo, tame causes na upar karo. Ne kasre ali na ghana sahib hamara makan par hata. Ne mein am ekdam ghabrai gai li ke Mola mane am sukam kai che. Pachi Mola mane kai che ke tame mane puchhu na ke mein sukam kau chu. તો મેં પછી આમ ઘબરાય શેઝાદ એક દિવસ સાહેબને ઉતારો હતો તો મેં શેઝાદ સાહેબને કહું સાહેબ મને નહીં સમજ પડતી લાઈક યુ નો એન્ડ સો મોલા કહે કે જો મારા સામે જો એમ કે આપણે કોઝિસના ઉપર રિસર્ચ કરીશું અને આપણે કેન્સર થવા નહીં દઈએ તો આપણે ઇલાજ કરવાની શું જરૂર છે એન્ડ મોલા એમ્ફેટિકલી સેડ ધેટ એન્ડ ધેન આઈ હેવ ગોન ટુ મોલા સજરત મેની ટાઈમ્સ ટીલ બુરહાનુદ્દીન મોલા વફાત થયા એવરી ટાઈમ આઈ વેન્ટ ટુ મોલા મોલા આસ્મી કોઝિસના ઉપર કેટલું રિસર્ચ થયું કોઝિસના ઉપર કેટલું રિસર્ચ થયું એન્ડ આઈ એમ રિયલી બ્લેસ્ડ બીકોઝ મોલાની ઘણી નજર હતી એન્ડ 2009 ધ હોલ કેન્સર કમ્યુનિટી ડિસાઇડેડ ટુ અબેન્ડન એવરીથિંગ ઇન ટર્મ્સ ઓફ ક્યોર ધ હોલ કમ્યુનિટી ઇવન નાવ ઇઝ ઓનલી ફોકસ્ડ ઓન કોઝિસ એન્ડ દેટ ઇઝ રિયલી રિવોર્ડિંગ બીકોઝ આપણે પ્રિવેન્ટ કરશું કોઈ ડિસીઝને તો આપણે કરવા નહીં જોઈએ સો This is my lab, really fortunate. I have a UN Security Council. I have students from every country in my lab, from Nepal to Japan to Taiwan to Korea to India to whatever. The Americans are quite a minority over here. And as Dr. Tasneem Ben said, I mentor students, publish papers, present, serve on a lot of leadership communities, do peer reviews. But let me get to the last slide. So my motivation for my career, for both Burhanuddin Mola and Mufaddal Mola is I really want to translate my findings and help cross this valley of death. Cancer is a valley of death. So we have to do something to cross this valley of death. And the goal is to learn from every Muminin in terms of how to improve the early detection and survival of cancer and very actively involved in a community effort to integrate clinical and genomic data that can specifically identify the vulnerabilities for cancer in our communities. So, shukran, Ibrahim bhai sahab, Shukran to all the Kasaya Ali, to SBMA for this opportunity. And please reach out to me. I really want to motivate Muminin to do non-MD related careers, and I'm truly blessed. And Khuda Mulani Umarne Taroze Kame Ahmed Darazane Daraz Kare. So, Mane Burani De Molai, London, London, 2006, Mane Mafsuya Tapu. And like he recognized me, he called me, and then me Arazvi no tikidi, and of course me Laili do masuyat, but I did not have the guts to keep my rida at work. So in 2012 or 13, before Burhanuddin Mulla passed away, one day I was in my office and Mulano photo mara office mahato, and I started to take my rida out, and I looked at the photo and I said, this is dishonesty. I cannot do this. Mulla is looking at me, how am I taking out my rida? And then I felt like I had a double identity. On one hand, I always said, Mulla, mane madad karjo, Ali, mane madad karjo, but maru maatu to khullu hatu. So mane em dhaniwar em khayal bhi ave ke farishta bhi sarma se, mara pase nahi ave, you know, ke me to maatu khullu che, me salwat par ubha rehne, par maru maatu to khullu hai. So it was very, very hurtful for me. And I remember having this conversation with my husband as we were driving to work, and I said, you know, Adnan, I think today I'm not going to take my rida out. And mind well, and I just full of, you know, I don't want to say the, but full of people who don't like Muslims, right? Including my own chair. And Adnan looked at me and said, apne sufi kalche, ye logo samne nahi kahi gaya, tum nikli ja jo, apne to mola ne khush kari rahe ache ne. So apne ka income ni zarurat thi. And I looked at him and said, like, are you serious? And he's like, yeah, you leave your job. I don't really care. So me rida na kari, I was a fish out of the water. And honestly, for all the women in the room, it was not about other people, it was about me. It was my fear of how I would get accepted to wear rida. And sorry, Alifabir, I'm taking your time. But I've been wearing rida for the last 12, 13 years. And honestly, I have to say this. Rida has got me so much mileage. Because I'm a Muslim, I've come from a third world country, I wear a hijab. I'm the representation of diversity, minority, women, everything. So after I started wearing rida, I get invited to almost every international conference, including SBMA. Thank you, SBMA. So I use it to my benefit. And honestly, it was me. And I'll just tell you one thing that a very famous scientist told me. He was an editor of a journal. So the first meeting I went to in Amsterdam about 13 years back, he came up to me and he said, you know, Munira, what caused this? Oh, you look beautiful. And I was like, oh, thank you. And I thought he was making fun of me. And he said, I always respected you as a scientist, but I respect you even more now. And I said, what? You have to tell me why you're wearing this. And I said, I'm wearing this because this is important for my culture and religion. By wearing this, it makes me feel strong and confident. And he said, if this is the value you have for your religion and culture, I can only imagine what you bring to your science. So next time you write an article, send it to me. I'm going to send it out for review. And I think, shukar che molano, ke, you know, aa type nu male che. You know, it's like I'm truly blessed that at the NIH, you know, I'm very well supported, respected. I get reviewed every 4 years. And a lot of times my reviewers and are very... I don't know how to use it. They come from a part of the country that doesn't treat Muslims well. And Allah no shukur che. So, ane Mufaddal Mulla ni bhi ghani nazar che, ne Burhanuddin Mulla ne. Bas ema jo ummeed che ke, one thing is ke, apne koi bhi profession karta hoi che, to apne em dhyan ma rakhu jo ve, ke apne apna profession si, mumineen ne kivi rite faido pochagi sakke. And ek maksad to hovo jo ve. I mean, I want everybody to go home and think, what is it I do in my daily life that can help, you know, other mu'minin? And that's it. I hope I motivated some people. Thank you, sir, for coming.
Thank you to all the panelists. I think the presentations have made us realize how, for me, how humbling the profession is and how inspiring your professions are, and medicine would not be where it is without the contributions of all your professions. So thank you. We have a few minutes for questions until our next transition. Any questions?
Yes, So I'm Matias Krasaber from Washington, D.C. I'm a first-year medical student, so I know Munir Antibasay and Tasim Bin very well. But my question is actually for Sakina Bin Chiba. So you're working with the patients who have chronic diseases with their medications. So can you just elaborate a little bit more on what is the process that you're working with them? Like, is it from the moment they're prescribed? Is it if they're having any trouble with them? Like, how exactly are you helping them every step?
Medicare, around about 2014 or 2012, basically kept all health professionals liable across preventative medication, right? Prevention is better than, you know. So if the patient had a cardiac arrest after the doctor prescribed lisinopril for blood pressure, the pharmacist gave them the medication, they went home with the prescription, and a month later they're in the hospital because they had a heart attack. The doctor is liable, and so is the pharmacist, because we never educated how important it was for them to have the lisinopril. So this is where my job is. Independent pharmacists, CVS, all these retail people, they just don't have time. And clinically, I will give them a call, speak to the patient, and I will explain to them, for those who want to listen, why they should be taking their medication once a day, when they should be taking it. Why is it important for them to have the lisinopril with their atorvastatin? Why they should make lifestyle changes. So basically, I am sort of part of the preventative medication system. So I work with the patients specifically who are already on the medications, and I reiterate and reinforce why they should be taking. So adherence is my thing. And it's now very big with Medicare, so everybody's very motivated to get that taken care of. Yes, very much. Insurances are really pushing for it because they do not want to be docked when the patient goes to the hospital. So they are paying for this service now. So NTM, what I do, the medication therapy management, is something that insurances are now actually paying pharmacists to do. So it's either I get my patients through pharmacies or through doctors. Good question, yes. Has to have my typical British. But Americans have having many flag waves. I'm actually going to say something to Ibrahim, but somehow I said that in California. So I saw me try to juggle life as a mother, as a khidmat guzar and everything. I'm very lucky. So education is actually the key. So this is one career you can really do that in. So shukur.
Good question. So psychology ma, behavioral medicine ma, so usually you get your master's on the way to your PhD. So that is why doctoral work is 5 to 6 years, because tamay pehla be varas master's nu kaam karo sho, and then bija tan varas PhD nu kaam karo sho. But really, it's a continuum. It doesn't make sense ke master's nu ek jagah karo ne PhD nu alag karo, because you're trying to develop a program of research. Ke tame ek ma specialization tamari thai tame diabetes prevention ma karushu. I actually did do a little bit. I shifted from cardiovascular disease to diabetes from master's to PhD. But honestly, diabetes is a well-known risk factor for cardiovascular disease. So when you think about pathophysiology, when you think about etiology, all of these things run together. So behavioral medicine masu thai che apne, we understand how interrelated tamaro brain and tamari aje apne ghanu suno, right, about mental health. So things things like depression and anxiety, how is it that these things are actually interacting with the body and then also interacting across the lifespan until, you know, if you are in your middle age, you are older adults, you're kind of at risk for dementia. So long story short, it's all part of the package.
An area that's been really lacking because there isn't enough cultural diversity in nutrition right now. I have been, working on things myself where you can use nutrient databases to build out recipes and then find out what the caloric nutrient value of it is, but that does take a little bit of time. And the other thing that we don't know is everyone makes the recipes differently. They're not standardized, and we don't have product labels. So it is difficult. If I'm using a calculator or a nutrition app, I do take ingredient by ingredient that I know contains calories and put it in there like that. Over Ashura, we actually had a really great breakdown of what contained what and what kind of calories were in there and the nutrient value. And so that software that is very, very expensive but does exist. It's just going to be a matter of time until we can just get more cultural diversity into the food that we're eating in the West. Yeah, and there are even here like some ones that you can take pictures of and then send them, and they'll tell you what you're eating and what you're not eating. I think when it does come to weight management, though, it ultimately comes down to the quality, and I think we are throwing calories out the window right now, because what you eat matters more than how much you're eating. There is still a component of calories in, calories out, but if you improve the quality of what you're eating, you'll notice that the calories automatically start to decrease. And by quality, I mean more fruits and vegetables.
Marab Hashem, what you're eating matters more than how much you're eating. And, your angle be sure. Aluminium for my Rasulla for my book, Kumwanta Tashtahi, and Ben Yala Baki Cheta would hear. And Rasulla and me for my checker, diet is a rotnet, coach is in Paris Nakaro. Paris Karo the Fakat, Echis, Salman Yokat Dekata, Kajur Kairash, Sunuja Sagla, Kajur Katata, and then Akavigal, Sukeshat, conjunctivitis. So for my book. Kim tamhe khajur khai raha ho aankh aavi gayi chhe bhai baju farmayo ke va tum khau jo jamni aankh ma conjunctivitis ho to daba taraf se chavi na khao bari aankh aavi ho to jamni taraf se chavi na khao khajur khau jo to mb m che ke kai parez nahi ane be niwala baki ho to barabar quantity is important pan ekivare કે જેવા તમે પહેલું સગલું જે મુકદ્દમો છે તેને બરાબર ફોલો કરો તો આ સગલી જે ચીજો રસૂલે ફરમાવી છે જમનના આદાબના બારામાં કે કેમ જમવું જોઈએ એ બરાબર ફોલો કરો અને શું જમવું જોઈએ બધું તો પછી પરહેજની જરૂરત નથી. જેમ વુઝુના અંદર વિશે કે પાણી હોય તો તયમ્મુમ ના થાય, પાણી નથી તો પછી તયમ્મુમ કરો. તમને એવી ચીજ હોય થયું કે બીમારી આવી ગઈ તો પછી બરાબર પરિપરેશ કરો. ડાયાબિટીસ થઈ હોય તો પછી શુગર ના લો. પણ ડાયાબિટીસ પ્રિવેન્ટ કરવા વાસ્તે તમે આ સગલું ફોલો કરો તો પછી થાય જ નહીં ડાયાબિટીસ, પછી પરહેજ કરવાની જરૂર નથી. એ મુકદ્દમો ઘણો ઇમ્પોર્ટન્ટ છે. હવે આ તો ક્યોર છે બધું, કે આમ હોય તો આમ ના કરો, આમ હોય તો આમ ના કરે બરાબર છે, કે પછી શું ખાવું શું નહીં એ હરામ બરાબર છે, એ પાછી એક અલગ વાત છે હરામની ચીજ ખાવામાં. તેમજ પછી એમ બી ફરમાયું કે એટલું આપણે પરહેજ અમને મૌલાએ બયાન માં ફરમાય શું હશે દુબઈમાં કે સગલી ચીજ પાસે પરહેજ કરીએ છીએ આપણે જમનના અંદર બાદ વખત હમુદાર તામ એમ એવી ચીજ હોય કે જે ખટ્ટી થઈ ગઈ છે મૂળ થઈ અને સાવર થઈ ગઈ છે એનું તેને આપણે ખાવામાં નહીં એનાથી પરહેજ નહીં ખાતા આપને તો પૂછે છે પછી આપ કે પછી એવા કલામસિંહ પરહેજ કેમ નહીં કરતા કે જે કોઈને તમે કહો અને એનું દિલ ખટ્ટું થઈ જાય, કેમ કે એ તો હંમેશા રહેશે અને બાદ વખત એનાથી તો એને મોત બી આવી જાય. આ તો તમારું ક્યોર બી થઈ શકે છે આવી ચીજ તો. આજે અમને ખાવું છો એવા હમુસા તો તામ જે આપણે થયું પેટમાં ગરબડ થઈ ખરાબ થયું તો એને ક્યોર કરી લીધું, પણ આ તો આમ એનાથી બચો કેમ એમ ધ્યાન છે રાખતા આ ગુનાથી બચો શું કાને કા લઈ જાય છે આપણે આમ. આ તો જાહેર સાડું જમનમાં તો હવે આ તો પછી એના સાથે કેમ કે આપણે તો હા જવું છે ને ફરિશ્તા બનાવવા છે. બધા સગલાને શુકુર કરું સગલા તમે લોકો બી આમ એનું મેં થોડો લેટ આવ્યો મગર પછી થોડું આ ક્વેશ્ચનના સબત સમજ પડી ગઈ કે શું કરો છો સગલા બધા ઘણી જગા આપે ખિદમત કરવાની.
Again, shukran to everyone, panelists, audience, Bhaisab. Please make sure you get information from the panelists. They're around for dinner, for lunch tomorrow to connect with you one-on-one. They would be very happy to share more information on their pathways and their lives, their barriers, and kind of where they're going from here. So thank you again. We will adjourn this session, and Bhaisab.
મોકે છે આપણે નીચે બેઠીને બી જમીએ છીએ જે અડબ છે એમાં એક ચીજ બેઠીને બીજી ઘણી ચીજો નમક ચાખીએ છીએ સગલું એ હાથ ધોઈએ છીએ મતલબ બિસ્મિલ્લા પડીએ છીએ નીચે બેઠીએ છીએ થાલમાં અને તે વખત આમ આપણે નમાઝમાં બેઠીએ છીએ એમ બેઠીએ છીએ અને પછી તો એનાથી એક શાયદ ડૉક્ટરો અહીંયા હશે ખબર હશે કે એનાથી આપણું ઇન્ટેસ્ટાઇન જે છે તે થોડું આમ દબાય છે તો એનાથી ઓટોમેટિકલી કમ જમવું એટલે કમ જમવા. અને મેં મોહમ્મદ બુરહાનુદ્દીન મૌલાને જોયા છે રસુલ્લાએ જે ફરમાવ્યું કે ટેકાસી કોઈ વાર રસુલ્લા મોહમ્મદ બુરહાનુદ્દીન મેં ખુદ જોયા છે 100 વર્ષની ઉંમરમાં બી આમ જમે તે વખત મૌલા દેખો નહીં દેખો વગર અંદર કેમ કે એ જમનની અઝમત છે કે કાં બેઠો કોના માયદ કોનું છે આ શુકુર અને એક અઝમત એની તો જે ખુશુ ખુશુ એ ઇમ્પોર્ટન્ટ છે. આ બધા તો એના સાઈડ આ છે કે એનાથી જે બાયોલોજીકલ ફાયદા છે એ તો એનું એક એનો ઇફેક્ટ છે પણ અસલ તો કે ખુદાના રિસ્ક પર બેઠો છું મેં તો કેટલું હજુ ખુશુસીને આમ જમીએ એક એક નિવાળો લઈએ 5 આંગળીસીને જમીએ ચમચીસીને અમને આદત પડી જાય છે મગર 5 આંગળીસીને જમવામાં બી એક ઘણી એનાના હિકમતો છે આમ જમન જેટલું જોઈએ એટલું બરાબર આમ આવે છે ઓમાં આપણે ઘણીઓ સમજ નહીં પડતી ચમચીસીને જમવા માટે એક ચીજ આમ એમ ફરમાવે કે પછી જમા પછી હાથ ધોઈએ તો આમ મોલા અમને ફરમાવે કે આમ આંગળીઓ ચાટવી જોઈએ અને એટલું જોરમાં કેમ અવાજ આવે આમ આંગળી ચાટે તો અવાજ આવો જોઈએ એટલું આમ આ સગલું ખાઈ આમ એમ નથી એના પાછળ કેટલી હિકમતો જો એને ફોલો કરીએ તો પછી બીજું પછી તો આમ ઓટોમેટિકલી ખુદા તાલા મૌલાને અફઝલ જગા આપજો ને મુસલમાને કયામત બાકી રાખજો. એમ બી ફરમાયું કે ચમચી આપણે થાલમાં જમીએ છીએ ને તો ચમચી મૂકીએ છે આમ એક પ્યાલામાં તો આમ ઘણી વાર આપણે ઉલટી મૂકીએ છીએ ચમચીનું જે ઊંડાલી જે આ છે એનું એને આમ ઉલટી કરી રહ્યા છે આમ અક્ષર તમે લોકો શાયદ જમતા આમ ઉલટી કરીને મૂકી દો આમ ઉલટું તારે સુધીનો આપણે ફરમાવતા હતા કે એને ઉલટું ના મૂકો એને આમ સીધું મૂકો એટલે એનું જે ગર્ભ હોય એમ અંદર તે આમ સીધું હોય ઉપર હોય એમ બેસેલ આમ એમ ફરમાવતા હતા એમ કે ઊંડું મૂકવાથી રિસ્ક કતરાય છે. સીધું મૂકો આમ, કોણ એટલી નાની નાની ચીજ બારી બારી કોણ શીખાવે, કોણ શીખાવે?
આપના તસવુરાત અદા કરીને અમારા જે ઇલમના ખુલાસાઓ અને હિકમતના ખુલાસાઓ કર્યા છે એના માટે ઘણું ઘણું શુકર. ઓલમોસ્ટ હવે કોઈ નોટ્સ લઈ રહ્યા છે ને આપણે આ બધું જમે કરીને આખું બધું કનેક્ટ કરી શક્યા. On that note, next session, Artificial Intelligence in Medicine in the Texas Ballroom. Shukran.